September, effective 33/20/20.
33/20/21.
It took effect from 31/3/2020 and operated till 31/3/2021. Act operated. The act was, the life of the act will not, if your lordship sees, yes, it up to extended up to 31/3/2021, 1 year. Then, my lord, it was extended from March to April.
Initially, it was from, it was to operate up to 33/20.
You know, it took effect from 33/20,
right,
and operated till 31/3/2021.
Right.
1 year and 1 day.
From March to April.
Yes. Notification. Well, this TOLA is in page, my lord, 362 of volume 1.
From April to June.
June. Now, March notification is at 408.
March
notification was 31st. Sorry, March. Yeah, 31st March notification is 410. 31st March, it got extended. It got extended, my lord, up to 30th April 2021.
That is page 462.
410. Then, my lord, on 27th April 2021, it got extended up to
36/2020.
Page? Page 413, 414. So this is the structure, 33/20/20 to 36/20/21.
Right. Now, so what is your contention then? What is the effect of all this?
Yes. Now, we said three things in TOLA, which your lordship may kindly recollect, page 362. TOLA is first, my lord, TOLA is an act of parliament. It's a legislation by itself. Point two, second point is section 2B defines specified acts. Income tax is one of the specified acts. So instead of not actually going and amending five separate acts, Wealth Tax, Income Tax Act, Binami, Finance Act, they brought one act and brought all these enactments as a bouquet, as definition of specified acts.
Right.
Second step. Third step, this specified act is not 2B.
Yes.
Third, section 2B of the act, which is at 362 and 363.
Section 3.
Section 2, subclause B.
That is correct.
2 and B. Now, Lord, please come to 3. 3 defines the notified actions on which TOLA will apply. My lord says 3-1A, where any time limit has been specified in or prescribed or notified under the specified act, in this case Income Tax Act, which falls during the period 20th March 2020 to 31st December 2020, or such other date after 31st December 2020, as the central government may notification specify in this behalf for the completion or compliance of. So two sets, completion of or compliance of. A, completion of any proceeding or passing of any order or issuance of any notice, which includes a 148 notice. Intimation, notification, sanction or approval, or such other actions by whatever name called by any authority, commission or tribunal, by whatever name called under the provisions of the specified act. We are concerned with two actions, Mark. One is issuance of notice. Another is, Mark, sanction or approval under 149. So act is specified. The actions are also specified.
So the only point is this. When TOLA was originally enacted,
yes,
it was enacted on 29 September 2020.
Correct.
But it was given retrospective effects from 30th of March 2020. Correct. The original period envisaged in TOLA was from 30th March 20 to 31st of March 2021.
Correct.
That was a statutory period.
Correct.
Beyond the statutory period, TOLA contemplated an extension by an executive act.
No, not an executive act. It's a statutory delegation, which is under 3.1. Okay. Yes.
But it's a statutory executive act.
Correct. Correct.
It may be delegated, but it was not delegated legislation.
No.
It was a delegated executive power to extend the operation of the act beyond 31st March 2020.
I have one doubt there, not.
Now, suppose that happened. Now, the reason we ask you is this. The power to extend beyond 31st of March 2020, I'll repeat, it may be a statutory conferment of power, we accept that for a moment, was by an act of parliament which was enacted before the amendment to section 147.
Very much.
The amended provision of 147 comes into force on 1/4/2021.
Correct.
Now, when parliament enacts a new law,
correct,
the new regime on 1/4/2021,
correct,
does that not subsume an awareness of parliament of whatever happened in terms of TOLA prior to that day?
Correct. Yeah.
If parliament wanted to incorporate TOLA in the amended regime, they would have done so expressly. So what we really now have to see is this. That's the basic question.
Correct.
When parliament enacts a new law with effect from 1/4/2021, new law in the sense amending the provision of statutory regime.
Correct.
The new regime. Does parliament still leave open the possibility of an extension of the period to issue notices under TOLA, which was enacted earlier?
Correct.
Does that still subsist post 1/4/2020?
Absolutely, the dotted question, Lord. Answer is in 363. Please come to the TOLA Act.
Should the answer be in TOLA or should it be in the new regime?
The TOLA Act says it should be in the TOLA. I'll give the reason.
I say that because this new regime was not in the I'm not certain on what the where to go, but we are just putting you the difficulty.
The answer is this, Lord. It uses the expression non obstante clause.
According to you, it's like the General Clauses Act, which has to be read into every statute.
One, and secondly, this is non obstante. TOLA Act is non obstante every other legislation which is specified. I'll show that, but three reasons I'll give, not one. There are three reasons. But the very direct question, not point. Actually, Lordship says this is the only thing to be resolved in this case. Heart of the matter. But three reasons we will give. Reason one. TOLA is not an independent act with any independent existence. It has no legal existence on its own. Its legal existence is contingent upon notified specified acts. Otherwise, TOLA has no use at all. It's not an enforcing legislation for any other purpose. It has no other purpose other than subserving the specified acts.
It has no independent legal existence.
It may have an independent legal existence. It has no legal purpose. I'm sorry in using the word existence. It has legal existence because it's parliament.
Right.
Legal purpose. It has no standalone legal purpose. That's the first point. Its purpose is to subserve the purposes of the specified acts. That too, confined to one important issue on limitation, nothing else. This cannot be missed out when we harmonize the post-amendment scenario. So first point is,
now tell us one thing.
Yes.
In the post-amendment scenario,
yes,
is there a provision on limitation in the post-amended?
Yes. And it does not exclude TOLA. Whereas TOLA says, I will operate on you, irrespective of the period, irrespective of the amendment.
But point which we'll have to answer is this. If the post-amendment regime enacted by Parliament under Section 147 of the Income Tax Act creates a limitation regime.
Yes.
Then was it the intent of Parliament that this limitation regime will operate independent of TOLA?
For three reasons. If you put the next three reasons.
The first point you said is TOLA has no independent.
If I give all the three reasons, this will question.
Specified action.
That is number one. Number two, my lord. TOLA has no purpose if Section 21B does not find place in TOLA. It has no purpose. Because TOLA is dependent on the specified acts. So any amendment that is carried out into specified acts, TOLA will continue to operate on the. It is not that Income Tax Act has been annulled. Unlike VAT has been annulled and GST brought. Income Tax Act is very much in existence. It remains a specified act all throughout, prior or post. A provision in the Income Tax Act gets substituted, not repealed, not omitted. I'm going to show the difference a lot. Three judgments of this court. A substitution perfectly goes and it's as though written in pen and ink of the specified act. That's what this court has said. It's the 1/4/2021 amendment is a substitution.
Third point.
So the second point is not the specified act. And third point, my lord, is specified actions under the specified act. They continue to remain only as specified actions. Irrespective of amendment or non-amendment, the nature of specified action has not undergone any change. Same notices have to be issued, same approvals have to be assessed, and not taxes have to be collected. So third, so it's not only a specified act, it is a specified action which remains the same in the substituted form. Fourth, Lord, please come to page 363 bottom. But Section 3.1 has three subclauses, A, B, and C. After all the three subclauses, if you come to page 364, Lordships, I may read the top portion. And where completion or compliance of such action has not been made within such time, then the time limit for completion or compliance of such action shall notwithstanding anything contained in the specified act, stand extended to 31st day 2021 or such other day after 31st March 2021 as the central government by notification specify in this behalf. Therefore, this non-obstante clause operates over and above. If there is a limitation prescribed under the Income Tax Act, TOLA will cast its shadow over it because it is non-obstante that limitation. And therefore, when the substituted provision, I'm going to come to the last. So let me go, this is the fourth point. When you have a non-obstante clause in TOLA, which is an act of legislation, not a delegated legislation, it's an act of parliament, it operates. So the extended notification, non-obstante clause will apply. So notwithstanding, my friends could have argued when they substituted the new enactment, if 149 has eschewed or excluded TOLA, they have a case. I don't have a problem. I have to concede. Notwithstanding should have been neutralized by the substitution. Whereas notwithstanding has not been neutralized by the substitution. It works in sync with the specified act. So what the third point is, non-obstante clause. But there are two more points. The fourth point is, my lord, what happens on 1/4/2021 is just substitution of a few sections of the Income Tax Act, not the repeal or the annulment of the Income Tax Act. And the last point, my lord, is most important. This will clinch the issue along with non-obstante clause. The fifth point is this substitution travels back in time for the past assessment years. Otherwise, we will be left with a complete hiatus because the provision goes, there will be no provision at all to recover for these years. So the substitution travels back in time. It's a substitution of the past period. And it is a conceded position TOLA applied for those past periods prior to its amendment. It's a conceded fact because high courts, all of them agree on this. So let us unfurl the dispute now.
Scheme now in the light of your submission once again.
Correct.
Let's read the statute.
Correct.
Read it before.
Yes.
But just quickly in 5 minutes, we'll look at the statute.
Please, please. My Lord, please see the old one. My Lord, it starts at 352. My Lord, did you oblige? In the volume one compilation. 352 is, my Lord, the old 147.
Yes.
Then, my Lord, 354 is the old 148, assessment, reassessment, or recomputation.
So the proviso to 147 confined us to 4 years.
4 years.
Except where there was a failure to disclose fully.
It becomes six, but 4 and 6. It was 4 and 6. And my Lord, then my Lord come
where
to.
Where is 6?
My Lord, that you'll get it at 149. I'll come to 6 in 1 minute. 1 minute. My Lord, then comes 354, 148. Then your Lordship wanted to see 6. Please come to 149. 355, section 149. It, my Lord, puts the period of 4 and 6 years in two buckets. Clause A and Clause B.
Clause 148 that you are relying upon. 148 you are not.
No. It's plot 148 is the plot once a sanction is obtained under 149 and we cross the muster at 147, we come to 148 by issuing a notice. So 149 is plot subclause B is 4. Then A is 4, B is 6, and C is 60. In the case of plot cross-border assets. Then, my Lord, 151 is, my Lord, the sanction or approving authority. For 4 years, there are a set of authorities. For 6 years, there are another set of authorities.
Where did you get that?
Please, 356.
Yeah.
151. These are the four, my Lord. And to add to this is GK Drive, because GK and Drive, my Lord, prescribe the mode and manner of disposal of the 148 application. This is how the old regime operated. 4, 6, then what? 149 approval, GKN to be followed, and then, my Lord, the notice has to be dropped or to proceed further. Now, my Lord, GKN has now become a law under the new regime. From 1/4/2021, the substitution of 147 is at 357. A mere escapement, my Lord, is good enough to initiate proceedings. Rather, reason to believe, recording, all that, my Lord, is now diluted. So, this is a substituted 147.
Okay.
357. Then, my Lord, substituted 148 is at 358. wherein Milord, there is something we need to embark upon. 358. May I read that? 140. Before making the assessments, reassessments or recomputation under 147 and subject to the provisions of 148A, the assessing officer shall serve on the assessee a notice along with a copy of the order pass if required under 148B of 148A. So 148 is subject to a 148A procedure, which is, my lord, the GK and Reichstag procedure made into law. That your lordship will get it in the very next page at 359. Conducting an inquiry, issuing a notice, giving an opportunity for hearing, all that, my lord. And under 148AD, I can drop it at that stage or proceed further after taking the necessary sanction or approval to the next stage of assessing the assessee under 147.
Right.
Last point, my lord, 149. My lord, now what is critical for your lordship's consideration is this provision. 149 is now, my lord, in your lordship's code for test. 149 and 151. May I read this provision alone, your lordship permit. No notice under 148 shall be issued for the relevant assessment year. A, if 3 years have elapsed from the end of the relevant assessment year, unless the case falls under subclause B. So 4 has become 3. If 3 years, but not more than 10 years have elapsed from...
3 years becomes 10 years
now. Yes. This budget yesterday, we have brought it down to 5. But during that regime, it was 10 years. Just 10 years. Unless the assessing officer has in the possession of books of accounts or evidence revealed that the income chargeable to representative so-and-so, which has escaped assessment, amounts to or is likely to amount to 50 lakhs or more for that year. But the proviso is extremely very important for this case, because all these cases come under the proviso, because they are past assessment. So you can't reopen 10 years of past assessment. You should restrict it only to 6 years. All assessment, my lord, prior to 31-3-2021 has to be done only under the old regime time limit of 6 years. So answer to your lordship's question, the substitution, my lord, collapses so well that the old law goes, the new provision gets substituted and takes care of the previous period, past period, and protects the interest of the assessee in enlarging the limitation only to the period of 6 years and not to 10 years for the back period. So 3 benefits, my lord, have been given to the assessee under 149. 4 reduced to 3. Threshold from 1 lakh increased to 50 lakhs. These are the 3 benefits conferred under the amended 149, substituted 149.
Which was, what is it?
Yes, 1, my lord, 4 has become 3 under 149, 1A. Six has become 10 under 149, 1B. But restricted to 6 years through the proviso for the past periods. And third, my lord, threshold filter for larger period from 1 lakh has been increased to 50 lakhs. And we had agreed, my lord, we are going on record. We said that in Asish Agarwal, we say this again in this batch. This again applies, my lord, for the past periods. It is not prospective. While we do a reopening for the past, not more than out of these 90,000 notices, which is, my lord, which initially started in their journey, more than 30,000-40,000 notices have been dropped because they didn't cross the threshold of these 50 lakhs. Proceedings have been dropped. Wherever it is confirmed, my lord, please, in your lordship judgment, please make it a law. Not we have a circular, but let there be free from ambiguity. These three things can form part of your lordship judgment for every assessing officer, also for guidance. Four has become three. So you should do only 3 years under this for the old period. We can't apply old 4 years. Your lordship can make it as part of your judgment for clarity and certainty, more important. And similarly, we can reopen only 6 years and not 10 years for the past periods. And the new threshold filter of, And thirdly, my lord, Proviso says that provided that no notice under 148 shall be issued at any time in a case for relevant assessment year beginning on or before first day of April 2021, if such notices could not have been issued at that time on account of being beyond the time limit specified under the provisions of clause B of subsection 1 of this section, as they stood immediately before the commencement of the Finance Act 2021. It's very, very clear. So, Lord, we can go only 6 years. And third point also, your lordship can factor in the judgment. Threshold, Lord, now from 1 lakh has become 50 lakhs. This will also apply for reopening. Let there be clear, Lord, instructions to us, because we are not anyway arguing. This is prospective. No. In this batch, that is not our case. We will extend the 50 lakhs benefit also. If reopening has happened for turnovers between 1 to 50 lakhs, they will automatically get dropped. And the fourth point we want to submit in this provision, my lord, the proviso does not have a non-obstante clause excluding TOLA. It nowhere excludes TOLA.
You mean the first proviso?
First proviso to 149. It does not. So, my lord, please let us now examine the interpretation of the law. A, we have a specified act called an Income Tax Act, which is in vogue. Income Tax Act has not been annulled. It's in vogue. We'll put that 5 tests. Test 2. The old provisions get substituted with the new provision, which means it becomes part of the specified act called Income Tax Act. 3. This amended provision applies for the past period. Otherwise, it'll be a hiatus. We can't do any assessment at all because old provision goes. So, the amended provision is not prospective, it travels back in time. 4. Therefore, TOLA, which is a lot colorless and neutral, because it applies to a specified act with a non-obstante obligation, will apply to the old provision till 31-3-2021 and will apply to the new provision till 36-2021. What is the difficulty? How do they now say that should be eschewed or excluded? On what basis? It's the question your lordship has to deal with. Neither the... And we will be doing this amendment across all the 5 specified acts.
The proviso... the first provider to 149.1 refers to the notice. If such notice could not have been issued at that time on account of being beyond the time limit specified under
the old law, which is 6 years.
Time limit to 6 years.
6 years.
Four years, but 6 years.
I can't know.
Is it your case that though under the old law as it stood, the maximum was 6 years, yet Because of TOLA, I can extend that beyond.
No, we have done it only for 6 years. We have extended time limit for issuing notice for that 6 years. Look, it's a very classic point. This is something I'm obliged to argue, which we argued that day also. We have not extended 3 years as 5 years. No. We have not extended 6 years as 8 years. No. We have only said, for these 3 years, I have an extended time limit till 36 to issue notice. So for the 6 years, I have an extended time limit of 2 years to issue notice. So six has not become, we are not using TOLA to reassess or expand 6 into 8. Not at all. Please take it on record. And all these proceedings are not for 8 years or 5 years. And that is not my friend's case at all. None of the 31 councils will not argue that. That is the conceded fact.
Now, but for TOLA, your notices will be barred
by limitation, even under the old regime and under the new regime.
Under the new regime, your notices would be barred by
limitation. Certainly without TOLA. Without TOLA.
That's conceded. Now, the question is whether, as a result of TOLA, will TOLA be read into the
answer is
of 140, the proviso to 149.1d as enacted subsequently.
For three, for following, even if it is acted subsequently, please, Malad, TOLA, if your lordship comes back to TOLA, what does TOLA say? TOLA says, notwithstanding the specified act. So, I'm going to show you 4 judgments of this court. When it comes to substitution is repealing the old law, pushing the new law, as though in pen and paper, we write the new law into the old enactment. That is the status of substitution. I'll show judgment of this court. This substitution has two-pronged process. Now, yes. If your lordships now take our brief note, brief note 3 at 436. PD 15.
Brief note 1 or brief note 2?
3. Brief note 3. In which, my lord, if your lordships comes to...
Brief note 3 is 21st March?
Yes, 21st March. Brief note 3, my lord. Brief note 3, which file? Of volume 2.
It begins by saying this honorable court began the hearing the matter on so and so.
Well, that is brief note 1. My lord, your lordship may ignore the separate brief note. Your lordship may come to compilation 2. Volume 2.
Final volume 2.
Final volume 2. Correct.
Okay.
It has 3 brief notes. Brief note 1, brief note 2, and brief note 3.
Got it.
My lords may come to brief note 3.
That is 436.
436.
Yes.
And my lord, PDF, please come to page PDF page 17, which is 438. My lord, has it? This is our case, and we support it with judgments. Can I read in from paragraph 5, my lord? I'll read paragraph 5, 6, and 7 together. TOLA Act covers the period 31-3, my lord has it? TOLA Act covers the period 31-3-2020 to 31-3-2021. Notification dated 31-3-2021 extends TOLA Act to 34-2021. And a further notification dated 27-4-2021 extended it to 36-2021. Notification dated 31-3-2021 was issued when the old regime was in existence. That's very critical. And notification 27-4-2021 was issued when the new regime took over. The following things are therefore critical. A. Neither old section 149 nor new section 149 excludes the applicability of TOLA. B. On the contrary, 3-1 of the TOLA through a non-obstante clause extends the applicability of TOLA both to the old and new section 149 and 151. C, the amendment carried out on 14-2021 is to the Income Tax Act, which is a specified act, and substitute the old law and travels back in time. 4, the proviso to section 149-1B deals with not only the past assessment years, but also the limitation periods prescribed therein. Now, Lord, please, the threefold test, para 7. As to whether or not a notice issued between 14-2021 and 36-2021 is barred by limitation by virtue of the limitation prescribed in the first proviso to section 149-1B can be determined by adopting a three-pronged test. A. The first step is to identify the assessment year for which the reassessment pertains to. It was begin or before 14-2021. Second step is to identify when the period of limitation expired under the old section 149-1B prior to its substitution on 14-2021. C. The third step will be subject to passing the second step. If the limitation indeed survived under the second step, then as a third step, a notice for reassessment can be issued by following the new regime prescribed from 14-2021. As an example, the three-pronged text can be examined. Let us assume that the relevant assessment year is 2013-14. The first step is complete. B. Under the old section 149-1B, the period of limitation expires at 6 years from the end of the relevant assessment year. This would be 31-3-2020.
Just one second. Let's assume that the relevant assessment year is AY 2013-14.
Yes.
The first step is complete. Then B. Now let's see B again.
Under the old section 149-1B, the period of limitation expires at 6 years from the end of the relevant assessment year. This would be 31-3-2020.
Right.
So it is notice beyond that is barred. Now please, TOLA saves it. Under section 2, read with section 3 of the TOLA, any action which was due to be completed on 31-3-2020 under the Income Tax Act was permitted to be completed by 31-3-2021. On 31-3-2021, by virtue of a notification, the compliance date was extended to 34-2021, and by virtue of another notification dated 27-4-2021, the compliance date was extended to 36-2021. In other words, what was due by 33-2020 was permitted to be completed by 36-2021. 4. As a consequence, it can be correctly stated that limitation under the erstwhile 149-1B was surviving on 31-3-2021 for the proceeding under the new regime as prescribed under the first proviso to section 149-1B. The second test, therefore, is passed. What remains is a mere compliance under the new regime. Since the limitation for 2013-14 survived on 31-3-2021 and a notice could be issued till 36-2021, the new procedure prescribed under the new regime must be followed and a notice can be issued. In all the cases on hand, the new procedure has been deemed to be followed by the judgment of this Honorable Court in Asish Agarwal. Therefore, the third test is also passed. If a notice has been issued for the year 13-14, after 31-3-2020, but before 31-3-2021, by virtue of TOLA, the notice should have been issued under the old regime. If it is issued between 14-2021 to 36-2021, by virtue of TOLA, the notice should have been issued under the new regime. The amendment merely regulates the procedure to be followed, and depending upon when the notice gets issued, the procedure will get determined. But merely because it is issued after the amendment has taken effect, the exclusion of TOLA cannot be automatically read to as pleaded by the assessee. So this is our case. And we'll support it with jurisprudence. Just two more pages, I'll read and complete. This is all my submission. I'll show the case plus and then resume. But please come to para 9. Two conclusions are irresistible. There is nothing to exclude or declare TOLA post 1/4/2021 as a dead letter to the Income Tax Act, because in terms of Section 2 of the TOLA, Income Tax Act continues to remain a specified act. The new amendment, which came into effect on 1/4/2021, is now part of the specified act. Neither the specified act nor TOLA or the notifications issued thereunder exclude the applicability of any of the provisions of specified act, namely the Income Tax Act. It will be legally untenable and unsound to interpret that the amendment with effect from 1/4/2021 is a part of specified act, travels back in time to cover past assessments, and yet the time limit as prescribed under TOLA and as extended through notifications have no applicability. The amendment to the Income Tax Act is not prospective, nor has the amendment created a hiatus, making itself inapplicable to past assessment years. When the amended act can apply as a specified act for past assessment years, there is no jurisprudential basis to exclude or disconnect the applicability of TOLA in applying the extended time limit. Such an interpretation would be counterproductive and also contrary for two reasons. Section 3.1 of the TOLA, which is an act of parliament, has a non-obstante clause overriding the limitations of Income Tax Act, which by force of law will get automatically extended to one of the specified acts, namely the Income Tax Act. Secondly, there is nothing even remotely to exclude the applicability of the TOLA or the notifications to the new amendment. The new Section 149 nowhere excludes the applicability of TOLA. An interpretation, as suggested by the assessees, would create a hiatus by saying new 149 would apply for past assessment without the parliamentary mandate of TOLA, and only the time limit as prescribed under 149 would apply. An amendment that gets carried out to the specified act on any time limits or any other prescriptions as envisaged in Section 3 of the TOLA would have to be read into the specified act because of the non-obstante clause, and not vice versa. The object of TOLA is to extend the time limit during the COVID periods. In the absence of any exclusion or inapplicability of TOLA to the amendment in question, a judicial interpretation to the effect will go against the very objective of granting extension of time, and such a harmful interpretation should be eschewed. TOLA loses relevance after 31/3/2021 is a myth. If the contentions of the assessee is to be summarized in one sentence, they contend that TOLA loses relevance after 31/3/2021 since the new regime has taken over. The high courts have also adopted this view, however, with great respect, incorrectly. The rationale behind the Honorable High Court's reasoning was inspired by the earlier round of litigation, which resulted in the judgment of this Honorable Court in Asish Agarwal. But before I read, I'll pass here for a minute. Now, there are two issues now in this court. One is resolved by Asish Agarwal, another is to be resolved in this batch. But all these notices, let me go on record, but all these notices are for the period 1/4/2021 and 36/2021. They were all issued only during April to June, but invoking the old law. This is a very important point I need to emphasize. Why Asish Agarwal came into. The department issued 90,000 show cause notices between 1st April 2021 and 36/2021, but invoking the old law. Thinking, so by virtue of TOLA, the old law which gets substituted continues to exist till 30th June.
Therefore, our court said that those will be deemed to be issued under the new regime.
That is all. So they said, having issued it, if you have not issued it, but the court made it very clear, you can't use this beyond 1/7. This is what happened in the earlier round. What we did, we issued it for the period 1/4 to 36, invoking the old law. So the Honorable High Courts rightly held there that look here, TOLA doesn't extend the life of this repealed act, amended, substituted act. So don't read TOLA to allow the act to pass on beyond 1/4 when it already gets substituted. They are absolutely right. We have no quarrel. This court upheld it in Ashish Agarwal. That principle was upheld, saying that TOLA has nothing to do extending the old law. It doesn't extend. But having issued it, we will preserve it under 142 and ask you to adjudicate it under the new law. So when we started adjudicating under the new law, not all the high courts, my friends, went. And they again succeeded by saying, in the earlier round, high courts have held TOLA cannot extend life. Therefore, TOLA is dead and gone. Therefore, TOLA cannot be applied for 1/4. That's the blunt short point argued. High courts have assessed it. But in the Ashish Agarwal batch, what was the reference for TOLA was a completely different purpose. And what is sought to be pursued is a completely different purpose. What now, all the high courts except Delhi have held this. Look here, in the earlier litigation, we have held TOLA cannot extend the old.
You can see the fact that but for TOLA.
No, it's barred by
limitation. But for TOLA.
Barred by limitation.
You would be barred by the proviso to 149.1B as an acted now.
Without an iota of doubt.
Isn't it?
Even, Malad, this is, then what will happen? Even prior to 31/3/2021, it will not be there. Because it goes to 33. That is the problem. If my answer to your lordship's question is two parts. Yes, it will be barred. How? It will be barred with effect from 31/3/2020 itself. Because we can't say, I will apply TOLA for 1 year. And I will not apply TOLA thereafter. Because TOLA is color. Lordship certainly puts a question. Our answer is, how do we now disconnect TOLA because of a substitution? As long as TOLA refers to the specified act, as long as non-obstinate clause applies for issuance of notice, non-obstinate clause applies for approval and grant, how does TOLA get excluded? That high courts don't answer. The only high court which went in our favor, the shortest possible judgment is Delhi High Court, and correctly. It only said, let's not be misled by the earlier set of litigation. Honorable Justice Manmohan Singh has ordered both the judgments. Very brief, 5 paragraphs, but good enough. Learned judge has said, look here, TOLA is independent of the substitution. TOLA Act will apply till 33/2021. Now that because of Ashish Agarwal, life has been given to 1/4/2021 to 36, the notification extending TOLA will apply also for the new regime. And how is this law, my lord, incorrect compared, my lord, to the decisions rendered by the high courts? This is all the question which your lordship has to resolve. And yes, oh, I see. Okay.
The only point, which we need to focus on is that the proviso to 149.1B,
yes,
in the new regime,
yes,
it says that no notice under 148 shall be issued at any time in a case for the relevant assessment year beginning on or before 1st April 2021. If such notice could not have been issued at that time on account of being beyond the time limit specified under the provisions of clause B of subsection 1 of this section, as they stood immediately before the commencement of the Finance Act.
Correct.
So it lays down only one eventuality.
Correct.
If you could not have issued a notice by virtue under this, you could not have issued a notice on the ground that on account of, those words are very crucial, on account of being beyond the time limit specified under the provisions of clause B of subsection 1 of this section, as they stood. So in other words, Parliament has created a fiction that you look at the provisions of 149.1B as they stood. immediately before the finance.
Correct.
Right?
Correct.
And if a notice could not have been issued on account of the notice being barred, by what? By the time limit specified.
Correct.
So it requires you to look at only one thing.
Correct.
It requires you to look at only one thing and no further. Was that notice barred by 149.1b as it then stood?
Under the old law.
Under the old law, on account of it being barred by the time limit specified in that provision.
Correct.
Now, if Parliament, post TOLA, requires you to look at only one facet and one facet alone, namely whether it was beyond the time limit specified in that provision.
Correct.
Can you look at anything else?
No, I'll answer it. It answers that question can be easily answered. Now, your Lordship has seen this provision. Please come to the old 149, which is at 355. Lordship, I'll answer it. Straight away, I'll answer that question. Please come to page 355, 149, 1B. That is what I narrated, the three steps. I now narrate it in law. Our written submission deals exactly this question only. Please see my Lord 355. 149.1b says, if 4 years but not more than 6 years have elapsed from the end of the relevant assessment year, unless the income chargeable to tax which has escaped assessment amounts to or is likely to amount to 1 lakh rupees or more for that year.
Now, the new 149.b does not refer to the quantum. It refers only to the time limit.
No, it refers to the quantum in the main clause itself. It's main clause itself.
It says only the time limit.
No difficulty.
It requires us to apply our mind only to the time limit prescribed.
I'm not in agreement. No difficulty. So, if your Lordship has seen 149.1a, plot the assessment year under question is 13-14, which is one of the assessment year in question. So, if you apply your old law, 13-14, 6 years expires from the end of the financial year 31-3-2020. Right.
But now
on 31-3-2021, TOLA comes into existence retrospectively. 29 September 2020 amendment dates it back to 33-2021. Step one. 2020. So, step one for assessment year 13-14. In terms of the old law 149.1b, time expires on 31st March 2020. However, on 33-2020, TOLA extends it under the old law up to 31-3-2021.
Right, you're right.
No, I understand. I'll answer that question.
But the new provision.
Yes.
Requires the mind to be directed to one facet and one facet alone.
Correct.
As to whether it was barred by limitation.
Correct.
Only under the provisions of...
It doesn't say only... I'll answer that question simple. But let us answer that question in simple terms. Please come to the old law. It's like this. We have a 149. How do we read the non... Can I take three steps, Malak? Malak, the expression only, fortunately I saw, expression only is not there. It's only Malak, our perception. Now let me take step one again. Please go to old 149 at 355. 149.1b, normal time limit of 6 years for 13-14 expires on 31-3-2020. Neither of us can quarrel on that.
If they had stopped at the words, if such notice could not have been issued at that time on account of being beyond the time limit, then it would have been very different. Because
they only
would have argued that, well, it could be beyond, it was not beyond the time limit because of TOLA. But once it tells you, because it, on the ground of beyond the time limit specified in the provisions of B of subsection 1, then it requires you to apply your mind only to that.
Answer is this, Mulot. May I put it this way? But
then look at something else to extend the time.
I'll answer it this way. Will your lordships agree on one fact? Then only we can open it further. When please come to TOLA Act, this is what I'm requesting your lordships to see. Please come to Section 2 of the TOLA Act. Section 2 puts a set of acts which include Income Tax Act. What does it mean in letter and spirit? They could have done it in two ways. Well, our parliament could have done it in two ways. They could have gone into the Income Tax Act. Give me 2 minutes. I'll just complete the submission. Because I have a flow, Murad. I may be wrong, but I want to present it. Please, Murad, step one, there is 149.1b in the Income Tax Act, till 31.3. This TOLA, instead of being an independent act of parliament, is written into the Income Tax Act, section 312. Then 149.1b as it stood on 30, and 312 of the Income Tax Act read on 33.31 will extend the time limit from 33.20 to 31.3.2021 as far as 149.1b is concerned. We have to agree on that because it's an act of parliament. So instead of writing it as one provision in the Income Tax Act,
then a separate law.
That is all. So what when we read, now where are we disconnecting? When we read 149.1b, the old law, my humble request to this honorable court is, read this, which is an act of parliament. The sanctity of this act cannot be decreased. And please read it as one subsection, one section of the Income Tax Act, because it says specify that. So once we read it as a section of the Income Tax Act, when your lordship takes the new law, please come to the new law. What does the new law says? As prescribed under 149.1b, now this TOLA Act says, notwithstanding time limit prescribed under the Income Tax Act. So we have to read 149.1b. Yeah, please. I'll show that. Very important, Mulot. 364. Please come to 364. Yeah, well, before that, Mulot, 363 also, but because the two notified actions remain the same. Where any time limit has been specified in or prescribed or notified under the specified act. Again, the expression used is specified act. But my only request is, when we see specified act, please read it as part of the Income Tax Act, Manal. Otherwise, we will be losing the...
Right.
Yeah. Sure. Which falls during the period 20th March 2020 to 31st December 2020 or such a day after 31st December 2020 as central government may notify specified. A. Completion of any proceeding or passing of any order or issuance of any notice, intimation, notification, sanction or approval. So here we are concerned with notice and sanction or approval. Please come to 364. And where completion or compliance of such action has not been made within such limit time, which is 149.1b, then the time limit for completion or compliance of such action shall, notwithstanding anything contained in the specified act, notwithstanding anything contained under 149.1b, stand extended to 31st March 2021 or such other day after 31st March 2021 as a central government by notification specifying in this behalf. So, my lord, my request to this honorable court is, read this as a part of the Income Tax Act. We can't ignore that fact. So, when we read it as a section in the Income Tax Act, 149.1b, which extends it only up to 31.3.2021, extends it now to 31.3.2021 because it's non-obstantive. So it is non-obstantive 149.1b. So now come to the new law 149. When we read as provided under 149.1b, And now, Mulot, please see, therefore, Mulot, we can't disconnect the TOLA Act from the Income Tax Act. That will not be, Mulot, in our very respectful opinion, that may not be the right approach. Once it becomes part of the Income Tax Act, that does not suffer an amendment at all. That's what we are trying to say. So under the old law, if your lordship's read 149.1b, read with the extended time limit, section 312, under the new law, because TOLA has not suffered any extinguishment, nor 149.1b excludes the applicability of TOLA. And therefore, when the new law 149.1b, read with 312, because it's not obstante, 149.1b. Now, where do we get, my lord, for this, in spite of the fact it is specified that, in spite of the fact TOLA has been extended duly and the provisions of TOLA is made applicable, we will still exclude TOLA. Where do we get it? We don't get it anywhere in the jurisprudence. That is our concern. And it's the COVID provision, my lord. We will be doing, my lord, and see, my lord, one more layer of confusion it can create. This is a substitution of law. There are other provisions of the Income Tax Act which has not been substituted. So what we will do post 1/4/2021 for the other parts of Income Tax Act, same TOLA will apply. For this part of Income Tax Act, TOLA will not apply. How do we get this? Where do we get this seed for such interpretation? Well, this is complete mutilation is the approach, which is what being happened and pursued. I don't deny it at all. But how do we put it in bits and pieces? Some part of the Income Tax Act, TOLA will apply even post 1/4. Your lordship should be then be able to hold TOLA is inapplicable to Income Tax Act post 1/4. That may be a right law, but that may not be not the right decision.
If you apply, they will again come. You have not yet applied.
My friends were talking of the amendment carried out in budget, but they are still in the bill stage. Enough heat is already getting generated outside the court before it becomes an act. So my lord, two important aspects, my lord. I have not put it in my note, but I finally put my concern. Two important aspects. I will support it with judgments. What I say now is supported by a judgment. Two important aspects. Please read TOLA as part of the Income Tax Act and not diverse of the Income Tax Act.
Principle.
And therefore, when you apply that for the old law, why do we disfigure it for the new law? Where is the extinguishment under the new law? That's one principle. Second principle, TOLA will continue to apply even after 1/4/2021 for other sections of Income Tax Act. But TOLA will not apply for 149.1b. But that is well, not complete an inequitable construct interpretation. These are the two points. And not all of them have held TOLA will apply till 31/3/2021. So, but either we have to say TOLA will not apply at all from day one, which is not even their case. My friends have to answer only three questions, Malot. I'll put it there and show the case law. Question number one.
There's another way of looking at it.
Yes.
TOLA in section 3 does not amend the period specified under 149.
Correct. Right? Extends.
Now, what TOLA does is, it merely extends the period for completion of the act.
Correct.
But that may be against the
other part. Let me answer.
149.1b, the period, original period is left as it is. TOLA does not amend 149.1b.
We are also not extending it.
So TOLA leaves the original period under 149.1b intact.
Correct.
It's not an amendment to the statute.
Correct.
What it, however, does is that if the action was not completed within that period, it simply extends the time period for the completion of the action.
Which is what we have done.
Now, one second. Now, what does the new 149b do? It adopts the period of limitation provided in the old 149.1b,
right,
and says that if a notice could not have been issued on account of being beyond the time limit specified there,
correct,
it cannot be issued here.
Without note.
So what TOLA did was, I can understand if TOLA had amended 149b if TOLA had amended 149.1b by providing that in view of COVID, the period of 6 years stands amended to 7 years or 7 years and 6 months, then you'd be absolutely right. Because the original period of 6 years then would have stood amended to 7 years or 8 years in view of COVID. Parliament didn't do that. Parliament only extended the period for completion of the action. Now, 149.1b under the new regime, 149.1b under the new regime falls back to the original period of limitation prescribed in 149.1b. Now, if we take it now that the TOLA, I take your point that TOLA has a specified act, etc. We have to construe what TOLA actually did.
Yes.
TOLA did not amend original 149.
That's not my case also, my lord.
Hey, all that TOLA did was extend the period for completion of certain actions. Now, the new regime does not adopt the extended period for the completion of actions, but adopts the original period of limitation.
This is what I need to, I may be allowed to correct, pursue only this path. I understand the question and answer it.
6 years, had the 6 years under 149.1b been amended by TOLA, then you would be absolutely correct. There's no difficulty.
Not even in original, may answer that very simple. Well, answer is this.
The statutory provision, because there's a deeming. What they do is they just extend the period for compliance.
Which is what,
leaving the original statutory period intact. And the new regime adopts only the original statutory period.
I'll answer that. Well, let me answer it in two parts. Not I'm conceding on the fact our attempt nowhere is to increase the assessment years from 6 to 8. Or let me complete myself.
That you can't do.
I have not done it. Let me go slowly. It is never our attempt today in this court to say because of TOLA, expand 3 assessment years into 5 and 6 assessment into 8. Read so in one. That is not our case.
Because so 3 remains 3, 6 remains 6.
Therefore,
we take that.
1, 2. This is what TOLA has also done. What TOLA does, what you could have done it in 6 years, we give you the time limit for issuing notice and completion of 8 years. It doesn't extend 2 more additional years. It doesn't add extra limitation. If you could have done it in 6 years, we now allow you to do it in 8 years. So step one, income tax 149 has one provision which says do it within 6 years. Income tax section 312 now has, let us read the specified act, now says 6 years plus 36-20-21. That is how the Income Tax Act will be now read, because specified act. Now the new law comes. Now new law says, it is always 10 years henceforth, but past the period, we will adopt the old regime. So it is one old 149.1b read into the new law. That's how we have to read it.
What we are really arguing is this, that under the new law, in deciding whether a notice would be barred under 149.1b of the old regime, you construe 149.1b of the old regime in conjunction with TOLA.
That's because for two reasons. I'm deeply obliged, Murad. For two reasons. A, TOLA is colorless. It is neutral. It doesn't mind whether you undergo an amendment or you don't undergo an amendment. Because it is part of the Income Tax Act. We have to remember this to be a section in the Income Tax Act.
Parliament could have said while enacting the new regime, on account of it being barred by the limit specified in 149.1b as it stood and as extended subsequently by TOLA. It could have incorporated TOLA in the new regime.
It is, in our respectful view, it's a surplus age. For this reason, we will now, then your lordship has to hold, TOLA will apply in parts. For some part of Income Tax Act, TOLA will apply up to 36. For some part of Income Tax Act, TOLA will. But see the kind of discrimination we are trying to make within the Act. When it's an Act of Parliament and it's figuring as part of the Act of the Parliament, but we have to now synchronize it in some way and a harmonious construction.
We are giving to the revenue the power to open an assessment which has very serious consequences. Unless there's absolute clarity.
I want to understand it only this. I'll put two questions and support it with judgments and I'll leave it there.
We get your point that once there is a substitution, The substitution is as if, you know, those classical English judgments say as if with
written pen and paper.
Pen and paper and pen and ink.
Yeah.
It gets.
Now please tell me now. So.
Yeah.
But my difficulty is today, please under what, on what principle am I thrown out is something I'm struggling to understand. Because the principle which we want to canvass is, A, should we read specified act income TOLA into income tax act or not? That's something I want to ask. I feel it should be read.
What we have to really see is, did TOLA extend the period of limitation or did it merely extend the period of time for completion of the action?
No, it is one and the same.
TOLA is not really extending the period of limitation, but extending the period of time for the conclusion of the action because of the...
Well, not this extension of time limit is only limitation. It's nothing else in law. But instead of doing the act within 6 months, you can do it by 1 year. What does it mean? It only extends time limit.
All right. Now on the judgments, what are the judgments?
Yes, I'll come to that. Please come to the judgments.
See, we're just putting a difficulty. There are lots of difficulties to ask for the other side also.
No, absolutely. That's a bit. I'll just show the judgments to your lordships. But in our compilation, if your lordships comes to but the famous Zail Singh's case, at 456, it is used for several provisions, including substitution. Yes. But PDF 35 in volume 2, running page 456.
Same volume, right?
On substitution, I want to show 2-3 paragraphs on 2-3 judgments because the language and text use is slightly different. But 4 times the law got substituted, or rather, in this case, 2 times. Please come to para 2. Section 13A was substituted, my lord, in para 4. But PDF page is judgment starts, PDF page, my lord, is 35. Lord, 456, my lord, para 2 is the old law, 13A, and para 4 is the substituted law. Please come to para 4. In the proviso to clause C of subsection 1 of 13A, the Haryana Municipal Act, so on. So, after the word after, the word up to shall be substituted. Now, what is the efficacy, legal efficacy of this substitution, para 23 to 25? Para 23, my lord, PDF page 44. May I read it? The text of section 2 of the Second Amendment Act provides for the word up to being substituted for the word after. What is the meaning and effect of the expression employed therein shall be substituted? The substitution of one text for the other pre-existing text is one of the known and well-recognized practices employed in the legislative drafting. Substitution has to be distinguished from supersession or a mere repeal of an existing provision. Substitution of a new provision results in repeal of the earlier provision and its replacement by the new provision. If any authority is needed in support of the proposition, it is found in West UP Sugar Mills Association was a state of UP for the line of cases. A 3-judge bench of this court held state government by substituting the new rule in place of the old, never intended to keep the old rule. Having regard to the totality of circumstances centering around the issue of the court, held that substitution had the effect just deleting the old rule and making the new rule operative. In Mangilal Pindalwal's case, this court upheld the legislative practice of an amendment by substitution being incorporated in the text of a statute which had ceased to exist and held that Substitution would have the effect of amending the operation of law during the period in which it was in force. In Koteshwar's case, a three-judge bench of this court emphasized the distinction between supersession of a rule and a substitution of a rule and held that the process of substitution consists of two steps. First, the old rule is made to cease to exist and the new rule is brought into existence in its place. But before I read the next judgment, why I'm reading para 25 is, irrespective of old 149 or new 149, TOLA does not get extinguished. And Income Tax Act has not been annulled. Income Tax Act continues to remain in the statute and TOLA continues to remain. Now, my lord, we don't, once it is a substitution, then my lord, TOLA has to be naturally read into the substitution. Where is the bar? Unless otherwise, either 149 says TOLA is inapplicable or TOLA Act itself gets amended, notwithstanding 3.1, this will not, extension will not apply to 149, the new amended substituted 149.1b. Neither of them has happened. Neither 149 excludes TOLA, nor TOLA excludes, my lord, the applicability of itself for this particular class. So substitution, my lord, the legal effect of a substitution is, it is stitched as part of the old act. And the applicability of TOLA is not in exclusion of any segment of the old act. TOLA doesn't apply in parts. It applies for the whole act. So in a substituted regime, how do we now disfigure it? It's not the first question. Now, my lord, may come to the second judgment, which is brought PDF page 48, 469. Not 469, PDF page 48. Second judgment. State of Rajasthan versus Mangilal Pindwal.
What?
Yes, my lord, PDF page 48, my lord, para 3, 5, 6, and 7 refers to four substitutions to the parent act. It's the rule, of course. It's a substitution of a rule. Four occurrences of substitution referred to in para 3, 5, 6, and 7. Now, my lord, the ratio is para 8 to 12. And they refer to, my lord, some English cases also.
Should I take a question or not? What is contemplating in your lord's mind?
Para 9?
Yes. Para 8, not para
8.
Para 8 to 8 to 12. I'll read para 8. The learned judges of the High Court have held that as a result of the substitution to subrule 2 of rule 244 by notifications 2975 and 2611975, provisions of subrule 2 of rule 244 as applicable during the period 19872 to 1975 so substituted, and as a result the said provisions cease to exist and must be treated to have been obliterated, and therefore rule 244(2) as it stood on 19872 was no longer available for supersession, amendment or substitution on 11376, since the same stood amended and substituted by the new provisions contained in notification 29 1975 and 2611 1975. The High Court has placed reliance on the following passage from Craig's on statute law and Sutherland on statutory construction. When an act of parliament is repealed, said law tendered in Surtees versus Ellison, it must be considered except as to the transactions passed and closed as if it had never existed. That is the general rule. Tendell CJ stated that the exception more widely. He said, the effect of repealing a statute is to obliterate it as completely from the records of the parliament as if it had never been passed, and it must be considered as a law that never existed except for the purpose of those actions which were commenced, prosecuted and concluded while it was an existing law. Since an amendary act alters, modifies or adds to a prior statute, all courts hold that a repealed act cannot be amended. That is, no court will give effect to a repealed law because the legislator attempted to amend it. As pointed out by this court, the process of substitution of a statutory provision consists of two steps. First, the old rule is made to cease to exist, and next, the new rule is brought into existence in its place. In other words, the substitution of a provision results in repeal of the earlier provision and its replacement by the new provision. As regards repeal of a statute, the law is thus stated in Sutherland on statutory construction. The effect of a repeal of a statute where neither a saving clause nor a general saving statute exists to prescribe the governing rule for the effect of the repeal is to destroy the effectiveness of the repealed act in futuro and to divest the right to the proceed under the statute, which except as to the proceedings passed and closed is considered as if it had never existed. Crawford interpretation of laws, it has been said, effect of a repeal generally, in the first place, an outright repeal will destroy the effectiveness of the repealed act in futuro and operate to destroy the incoherent rights dependent on it as a general rule. In many cases, however, where the statutes are repealed, they continue to be the law of the period during which they were in force with reference to numerous matters. The observations of Lord Tenterden and Tyndall CJ referred to in the above-mentioned passages in Craig's on statute law also indicate the principle that on repeal a statute is obliterated is subject to the exception that it exists in respect of the transaction passed and closed. To the same effect is the law laid down by the court. This means that as a result of repeal of a statute, the statute as repealed ceases to exist with effect from the date of such repeal, but the repeal does not affect the previous operation of the law, which has been repealed during the period it was operative prior to the date of such repeal. The effect of amendments that were introduced by subrule 2 of rule 244 of the rules by notification 2975, 2611-25, whereby the said rule was substituted with effect from 2975 and 2611-79, whereby the said rule was substituted in the rule which was introduced on 19872, ceased to exist with effect from 29-1975, but it was operative during the period 19872 to 1975. It is settled law that a rule made into existence of a power conferred under 309 of the Constitution can have retroactive operation. Since subrule 2 of rule 244 of the rules as introduced in August 1972 was operative during the period 19872 to 1975, it could be amended in exercise of the rulemaking power under 309 of the Constitution so as to operate during the period 1982. The notification dated 11376 by substituting subrule 2 of 244 repealed the said provision that was operative during the period 198 so and so and replaced it by another provision which was to be operated during the said period. The said notification cannot be held to be invalid on the basis that the said amendment sought to amend a provision which was not in existence. the statement of law in Sutherland on statutory construction, on which reliance was placed by the learned judge of the High Court, that the repeal law cannot be amended, has no application in the present case. But I cited this paragraph only for this reason. If it is a mere repeal without a substitution, my lords, we'll have a difficulty in applying TOLA because it won't operate. Whereas a repeal is followed by a substitution, and TOLA exists in the same Income Tax Act somewhere else. So, law, old law goes, new law comes, and TOLA remains into the Income Tax Act. So, in such a situation, the distinction between a repeal and a substitution should be, my lord, borne in mind when we apply the principle for TOLA. Second judgment is relevant for that, my lord. And now the third judgment. Last two judgments, my lord, is this, my lord, at PDF page 53, 474. Gotu Mukala Venkata Krishnam Raju versus Union of India. My lord, it is again a case of substitution. Para 3 and 4 says so. Qualification of tribunal members. My lord, the ratio is in paragraph 18, PDF page 64. Only one paragraph. Yeah. What does substitution signify?
If Mangilal Pindwal, what is the para you say? Para 8 yes. to 12.
8 to 12. 8 to 12. Then in Guttu Mukalla, my lord, para 3 and 4 refers to the substituted provisions and the ratio is paragraph 18 at PDF page 64. May read it. Yes. Ordinarily, wherever the word substitute or substitution is used by the legislature, it has the effect of deleting the old provisions and make the new provision operative. The process of substitution consists of two steps. First, the old rule is made to cease to exist, and the next, the new rule is brought into existence in its place. The rule is that when a subsequent act amends an earlier one in such a way as to incorporate itself or a part of itself into the earlier, then the earlier act must thereafter be read and construed as if the altered words had been written into the earlier act with pen and ink, and the old words scored out so that thereafter there is no need to refer to the amending act at all. No doubt, in certain situations, the court, having regard to the purport and object sought to be achieved by the legislature, may construe the word substitution as an amendment having a prospective effect. Therefore, we do not think that it is universal rule that the word substitution necessarily always connotes two severable steps, that is to say, one of repeal and another of fresh enactment, even if it implies two steps. However, the aforesaid general meaning is to be given effect to unless it is found that the legislature intended otherwise. Insofar as present case is concerned, as discussed herein after, the legislative intention was to give effect to the amended provision, even in respect of those incumbents who were in service on 1/9/2016. So next variation. Lord, if your lordship holds this is only a repeal, the consequences are different. If your lordship holds, no, this amended law is prospective, then a different view is possible. But today, both of us are in sync. This old law is a substitution, and the old law travels back in time. Now to say, I will still diverse. The applicability of TOLA is several steps away from jurisprudence. That's why we showed this judgment. Each judgment is for one shade. But one last judgment and one judgment on non-obstant. With that, will not I close it. But your lordships comes to the court issuer case, which is about PDF page 23. This is the one more variation in law. You bring one notification which is in place. You also bring another notification later without repealing the earlier notification. What is the legal effect? We can test TOLA in all these three circumstances, Mulat. I have no difficulty. Mulat, this judgment is for this purpose. This is Mulat PDF page 23. Koteshwar Vittal Kamal Kamath versus Rangappa Baliga. Only two paragraphs, 7 and 8. There is one notification in place, one order in place. Then there is a subsequent order also in place without repealing the earlier order. So what is the efficacy of the subsequent amendment? That was the question, Balot. Please see when both of them coexist in the enactment. The third variation, either repeal or prospective or coexistence. These are the three variations where you want to show in contrast to substitution. Please come to paragraph 7, not PDF page 28. The question of validity of the contracts in these circumstances will clearly depend on whether future contracts in coconut oil, but I'll read four lines below that. The only two earlier prohibitory orders, my lord has it, four lines down, yes. The only two earlier prohibitory orders were prohibitory order 1119 and prohibition order 1950. On this aspect, reliance was placed on behalf of the respondent on the circumstances that under entry 48 of list 1 of the 7 schedule to the constitution, the parliament had the exclusive power to legislate on the subjects of stock exchanges and future markets. And this court has already held in Waverly Jute Mills Company versus Raymond that the legislation on a forward contract would be a legislation on future markets, so that state legislature is not competent to legislate in respect of forward contracts under its power of legislation conferred under entry 26 of list 2, which relates to trade and commerce within the state. On this basis, it was argued that the state government on 8th March 1950 was not competent to issue the prohibition order 1950, as that order was very clearly a piece of legislation on forward contracts. It appears to us that in the present case, we need not express any final opinion on this question. If it is held that the government of Travancore Cochin was competent to pass this prohibition order of 1950 because the power was derived under Article Act 8 of 1112, which was validly enforced in the state on 8th March 1950, then that would be the order which would continue in force under 73(2) of the Act. On the other hand, if it is held that the state government could not have competently passed the prohibition order 1950 because it was a piece of legislation on forward contract, that order would have to be treated as void and non-est. Thereupon, the earlier prohibition order 1119 would continue to be in force right up to 30th March 1950. Act 8 of 1122 had continued in force the prohibition order of 1119 with a qualification that it was remain in force until it was superseded or modified by the competent authority under the provisions of Act 8 of 1112. When the prohibition order of 1950 was purported to be issued on 8th March 1950, it was not laid down that it was being issued so as to supersede the earlier prohibitory order of 1119. If it had been a valid order, it would have covered the same field as the prohibition order of 1119 and consequently would have been the effective order which the rights and obligations of the parties had to be governed. On the other hand, if it is held to be void, this order will not have the effect of superseding the earlier order of 1119. Learned counsel for the respondent, however, urged that the prohibition order of 1119 cannot in any case be held to have been continued after 8th March 1950 if the principles laid down in NTA Mehta Majid case is applied. Then Lord, please come to, that is once old rule, the new rule is held to be invalid. Please come to paragraph 8, with that element. On that analogy, it was argued, I'll just read sentence before that. Once the old rule has been substituted by the new rule, it ceases to exist and it does not automatically get revived when the new rule is held to be invalid. On that analogy, it was argued that if we hold that the prohibition order of 1950 was invalid, the previous prohibition order of 1119 cannot be held to be revived. This argument ignores the distinction between the superposition of a rule and the substitution of a rule. In the case of Mehta Majid, Rule 16 was substituted for the old 16. The process of substitution consists of two steps. The old rule is made to cease to exist, and the new rule is brought into existence in its place. Even if the new rule be invalid, the first step of the old rule ceasing to exist comes into effect, and it was for this reason that the court held on declaration of the new rule as invalid, the old rule could not be held to be revived. In the case before us, there was no substitution of prohibitory order of 1950 for the prohibition order of 1119. The prohibition order of 1950 was promulgated independently of the provision order 1119, and because of the provisions, it would have had the effect of making prohibitory order inoperative if it had been a valid order. If the prohibitory order is found to be void ab initio, it could never make prohibitory order 1119 inoperative. Consequently, on 30th March 1950, either the prohibition order 1199 or the provision order 19 must be held to have been enforced in Travancore Cochin, so that the provisions of section 7325 would apply to that order and would continue to be enforced. This further continuance after Act 5 depends on the validity of Section 3 of 1950 Act, because 73(2) purported to continue the order in force under that section, so that we proceed to examine the arguments. So, Blot, yes. So, this is a case of a perfect substitution. The old law is no longer there. So, Blot, we can't diverse it. The last judgment on non-op. Can you read non-op statement?
Just give us a citation.
Yes, yes. Only one judgment, Blot.
Page?
Blot, it is in PDF page 133.
Was the name of the judgment?
Yes. Geeta was a state of Uttar Pradesh. Citation number 2010-13 SEC 678. Not paragraph 37 to 45 refers to all the earlier rulings of this court. Not the significance of a non-obstante clause cannot be lost sight of. And my lord, post the amendment into 149, non-obstante clause in the TOLA Act has not undergone any. And my lord, can I only just see, my lord? Well, but if your lordship comes to PDF page 143, please come to paragraph 38. The non-obstante clause can reasonably be read as overriding anything contained in any relevant existing law, which is inconsistent with the new enactment. The enacting part of a statute must, where it is clear, be taken to control the non-obstante clause, where both cannot be read harmoniously. And what, we now cannot choose non-obstante clause for one section of the Income Tax Act and not do it for the other section. But same lot, just to manage. And lot, this is very important, lot. Para 43. The purpose of a non-obstante clause remains the same under the TOLA Act and under the amended notification under the TOLA Act. The purpose remains the same. Purpose has not undergone any change. If purpose has not undergone any change, non-obstante clause should be given the same meaning. And but one last thing I have to show. The two amendment notifications, if your lordship comes, please come to the amending notification, both prior to the new act and the post-new act, 410 of volume 1. Of volume 1. Well, there has been an extension under the old regime and an extension under the new regime. That's very, very important.
One was before the new regime and one was after.
Another new regime. And both the notifications, my lord, they are colorless. They are just referring to the provisions in operation. So we will be, my lord, there is one more reason to, my lord, shoot down the point of my friends. Please see, my lord, 410. This is the extension under the old law, where it refers to subclause capital A, subclause A.
Which page?
410. Volume 1.
March 31st, 2020.
Yes. 31st March 2021, at which point of time, the old regime continued. The new regime took effect only from 1-4. Please see the expressions used in subclause A. The completion of any action to subclause A of section 3 of the Act relates to passing of an order under 13 of 144C or issuance of notice under 148 as per time limit specified in 149 or sanction under 151 of the Income Tax Act. So this is the old law. Same thing is repeated under the new law. which is lost sight of by the high courts. 27.4, it uses the same expression. How could they now say that TOLA will not apply? Please come to me, not 413. So there is an amendment carried out after the new regime to answer to your lordship's question. Was there an act? There was a conduct. A delegate deriving its power from the statute acts post to the new amendment, which has been completely not addressed. 413, my lord.
Extended to 30th June.
Yes. Where? See the provisions. Subclass B, not sub at 414. I'm sorry, I just read only that. One last minute plot. Please come to 414, subclause B. The completion of any action referred to in subclause A, clause A of subsection 1 of 3 of the said act, relates to passing of an order under 13 of 144C or issuance of a notice under 148 specified under as per time limit specified in 149 or sanction under 151. They are 149. How can we miss TOLA? So it refers to 148, it refers to new 149 and says, please extend it.
We'll start with the other side tomorrow.
Lord, Lord, only one request. Either 3 minutes today or 3 minutes tomorrow. Lord, he has worked with me in this matter. He has a point. He says he wants to address one point.
Today, no problem. Tell us. Thank you, Mr. Rangadam.
Extremely obliged for this. Very patient hearing. Lord, my last, before I go, Lord, the answer to your lordship's question, TOLA, was it extended under the new regime? It got extended to the new regime with reference to the new 149. That's the answer. So please read the new 149, read with TOLA. Extremely obvious.
I'm very grateful for the opportunity.
Yes.
Such the proviso to 149.1b of the new regime is in essence a gate pass. All it deals with is the limitation or the time limit specified under the old law. So therefore, the test that one must do is solely under the old law, and check whether the period survives. If they survive, we enter the new regime. Now, your lordships, to your lordship's pointed question, since the proviso to 149.1b says time limit specified under the old law, should we divorce TOLA or should we not divorce TOLA? Now, the pointed aspect is the answer lies in TOLA. Your lordships may see volume 1, page 364. 364 says it operates notwithstanding and tampers the very time limit specified in 149.1b of the old regime. So until 31/3/2021, when we read the limitation of 149.1b of the old proviso, of the old provision, it is automatically read at all points of time with TOLA because TOLA tampers that very provision. Therefore, when the new provision takes us back to the old regime's 149, at all points of time, the new provision also only relates the old provision vis-a-vis TOLA and not otherwise. So as it existed prior to 31/3/2021, 149.1b of the old regime is automatically at all points of time read with TOLA. And even if we for a second assume that the amendment has not come into force, it is 149.1b of the old regime read with TOLA. And when the new provision after its amendment relates back to the old regime, it is the old regime read with TOLA. And that's the only point I wanted to.
Thank you.
A pleasure to address this court. Deeply obliged.
So, commence arguments tomorrow?
Yes, ma'am.
Who will commence arguments tomorrow?
Ms.
Pardiola will come. Let's try and wrap up tomorrow so that, you know, next week will be again a new week. This matter, Parmeshwar, seems to be good for tomorrow. There is a review which has been filed in the All India Judges on the allowances.
Yes,
Mr. Venkat.
Yes, we have already
given him a copy of that. So he's appearing as a amicus, I think, in that.
Lord, I'm assisting. I'll ask the court to my friend also. We have given it to the ministry. We are working on it. But what I told them, we want to put a chart. What is clearly allowable, we want so that our judges should not get blood less.
Everything is allowable.
In fact, there is not in Supreme Court, under the Supreme Court guidelines, some overriding power is there on TDS. But we are just checking up whether High Court also has a similar power.
Right.
We'll just extend it. We'll just give it as much as possible without any difficulty. Our judges will do it.
Your Lordship said put it up at 2 for the pension hearing, my lords, on the
tomorrow.
Tomorrow.
I think All India Judges pension, we should start next week because this will take the whole day tomorrow, actually. We'll take it up maybe on Tuesday in the afternoon or something like that. Yeah. Tomorrow, if you can just come around 4 o'clock, so we can then see what the situation is. Yeah. Just like this, 5 minutes
very
before
well.
We write.
Very thank well. Great.
Pleasure to address this court. Deeply obliged.